Okay, church, I think we got to... I'll give you 10 more seconds to fellowship. Maybe 15 if you're nice. Good morning, Forrest. Good morning. All right. Let's find our way back. All righty, we're getting there. We're getting there. Good morning, Bethany. Well, you know how I like to start. Good morning, church. How's everybody doing? Yeah? You guys doing good? It is so good to have you. If you're new here, welcome to the Church of the Outer Banks. We are moving along through the book of Acts, and I know it's been very enjoyable for me as we're watching how the Holy Spirit is transforming lives through the book of Acts. We've been preaching there. I think we're in week number 5 right now. And today we're going to be talking about probably one of my favorite characters in the entire Bible. His name is Stephen. And if you've read the book of Acts or you've looked through the scripture, you know that his life is a powerful testimony. He was the first Christian martyr, the first person historically that we have that died for their faith in the book of Acts with the early church. And every time I read his story, I get something new, something fresh. It inspires me to live my life fully for the gospel. So we're going to be looking at Stephen today and how the Holy Spirit was filling up the early church and they were witnessing. And as we've learned, it went from 120 to 3,000 to 5,000 people in a matter of days. And it was like an uncontrollable fire. The gospel was sweeping through the Roman Empire. And I've told you pretty much every week that historians say that by the end of the second century, a fifth of the Roman Empire were converted to Christianity. And it was these early believers that were walking in the Spirit and walking in the Word. And they were giving their lives and serving and being generous. And the world couldn't understand. And they were getting converted. So that's where we've been. It's been so excited. But as I'm reading going through Acts, you're seeing ordinary people like you and me, willing to say yes to the call of God, and there is revival. And that's what we come to in Acts chapter 6. We're looking at this ordinary person, but it reminds me of what's going on with one of our missionaries. And I know I showed you this picture. I mean, this is so encouraging. As I was reading through the book of Acts, you're kind of like, where's the revival that we read in the early church? Where is it? And let me tell you, church, it is happening. So Logan Hyman, one of our missionaries, he went to Cairo, Egypt for a 3-day outreach. The first day was 12,000 people. By day 3, there was 24,000 people that came to hear the good news of Jesus. Isn't that awesome? Now listen to this, it even gets better. There were 17 different people, from BMXers to basketball people, all these different people willing to fly over there, getting sent by the local church, and we had one of those people willing to go over there and just say yes to Jesus. That's it. Not scholars, not theologians, not these big wigs that know all about the Bible, ordinary people like me and you that said, I want to see the great commission fulfilled. Guess how many people came to know the Lord? And these are primarily Muslim people. And Logan was telling me that it's not illegal to have Christianity in Egypt, but it is illegal. And there is persecution for those who are Muslim that convert to Christianity. Guess how many people came to the Lord by day 3? 10,000 people came to know Jesus by day 3. 10,000 people. And this is a picture of Logan right here doing these tricks, and he's sharing his testimony. I mean, how amazing would that be to get on a bike and do that? I get on bikes and I skin my knees. This guy's doing airs over ramps, and there's all these kids that are coming. And he said, Jamie, there's revival. And I was thinking, yes. And I was thinking, this is what we see in the book of Acts. And I want to encourage you, it's ordinary people that just say yes to the call of God. And there's people just like you that the Holy Spirit's saying, will you just say yes with your gifts? It's as simple as being obedient, and it's amazing the places that God will take you with a willing heart. And I feel like we, as a church, we get to take part in this because we were able to give and to send and to pray. So that's where we're at, church. Acts chapter 6. It's an ordinary guy named Stephen. He's not an apostle. He's not a scholar. He's a guy that said yes. And I can tell you, as you read the book of Acts, this guy God used to change the entire world. Stephen. He was the first person to die for his faith, the first Christian martyr, and his story marks a significant turning point in the book of Acts. At this moment, if you remember, Acts 1 through 5, Jesus said, go into the world. Do you remember that? Go, you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea, Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. So Jesus, he says, wait. He says, I'm going to fill you up with the Holy Spirit. And when I fill you up with the Holy Spirit, I want you to stay here. I want you to go to Judea, Samaria, and I want you to go all the way to the ends of the earth. And that was the call. But yet, the apostles, up to chapter 5, they were all still in Jerusalem, probably holding hands, singing Kumbaya. They hadn't got outside Jerusalem yet until an ordinary guy with no theological training that we see, he comes in with this witness, and it propels the church outside of Jerusalem. And not only that, his witness does that, but it converts a guy that by the name of Saul, who would become, let's hear it, Bible scholars, who? The apostle, very this section right here. And there's not even that many people over there. I'm proud of you guys. The apostle Paul. And as you know, the apostle Paul wrote 13 books of our New Testament. Apostle Paul, all the scriptures that you know in the New Testament, so many of them were written by the apostle Paul. God used him to change the world. Well, it came down to a witness from this ordinary man that you will see change Paul's life, that he watched the stoning of Stephen, and it made such an impact. If you read in his life, he will quote from Stephen's sermon 4 to 5 different times, arrested by the impact of an ordinary man. Are y'all with me? Someone can say amen. Amen. Ordinary people that God wants to use to change the world. Stephen. So let's read about him. The church is stuck in Jerusalem until this guy Stephen comes. Let me read verses 1 through 6. Turn in your Bibles to Acts chapter 6 if you like. In those days, when the number of disciples was increasing, the Hellenistic Jews among them complained against the Hebraic Jews because of their widows were being overlooked in the daily distribution of food. So the 12 gathered all the disciples together and said, it would not be right for us to neglect the ministry of the Word of God in order to wait on tables. Verse 3, brothers and sisters, choose 7 men from among you that you know are to be full of the Spirit and wisdom, and we will turn this responsibility over to them and will give our attention to prayer and the ministry of the Word. And look at verse 5, the proposal pleased the whole group, and they chose Stephen, a man full of faith and the Holy Spirit. This is what we know about Stephen. It says that he was a man full of faith and the Holy Spirit, an ordinary man, not a scholar, not a theologian, a man who said yes, that was full of faith and full of the Holy Spirit. And that's what we know about this guy. So what was happening here, I'll give you a little bit of context because you know how much I love context, is we're introduced to him. He's a Greek-speaking believer, and the apostles had a problem. You see, the church was exploding. I told you it was going from 120 to 3,000 to 5,000. I mean, can you imagine the amount of growth and pastoral care that needed to be done? And so these Greek-speaking widows, we call them Hellenists, okay? They were being overlooked. There was a racial problem in the church because the locals, the Jewish widows, were getting more attention than these Grecian widows. And there was a division that was getting ready to come. And so the apostle says, listen, we got to stay focused on preaching God's word. That's what we have to do. That's our calling. People need to hear the word of God. And so, but we got to choose people to help us. And so they choose seven people. And one of those people, his name was Stephen, a man full of faith and full of the Holy Spirit. And as we look at his story, you realize that this is not a glamorous call. This is seemingly unimportant. They didn't elect him to be the group president. All right, they don't elect him to be a great teacher. He is just a table waiter. That's it. A table waiter waiting on these Hellenistic Jews, these widows. What a seemingly insignificant job. But in the hands of the Lord, church, there is nothing greater than a servant. Am I preaching to anybody? In the hands of the Lord, you know what he's looking for? He's not looking for these spectacular big gun speakers. He's looking for someone that says, I'm all in. I'll do whatever it takes. Stephen said, I'll do whatever it takes. If it means waiting on tables, I'm all in. And you're going to learn in Scripture, it's the servants that see the miracles. Because God is looking for servants, just people to say, hey, I'm willing to help. So Acts 6 and 7, what happens is, and this is so powerful, is that Stephen, he's serving with so much passion, and he's serving with so much. This is not beneath Stephen. He just wants to serve. And it gains the attention of the religious leaders, and they're looking at this man, and they're saying, what is it about him where he doesn't complain and he's not entitled and he just wants to serve? And many people come to know Jesus because he's just a servant. And so what happens is, because so many people are coming to know the Lord, it gets the attention of the religious leaders, and they want to discredit Stephen. Because anytime God starts to work, there's always opposition. Y'all with me? When God starts to use your life, you shouldn't be surprised when opposition comes. It's part of the deal. So opposition comes, and I love this verse right here. Acts 6:10 says, and they could not stand up against the wisdom and the spirit that God gave him as he spoke. An ordinary guy. We don't understand how he's communicating so great because the Holy Spirit was filling him. An average, ordinary servant. And it just encourages me so much. So, okay, so what happens is, we'll keep going in this because it's a pretty big story. Acts chapter 7, they bring Stephen before the Jewish council, the Sanhedrin. This is a 71-person council, and if you can go home and read the story, but he preaches this incredible sermon, the longest sermon in all of the book of Acts. This ordinary guy stands up, and he preaches to 71 people, the most educated theological people in the land, and he's looking them straight in the eye, and he's speaking truth. The Holy Spirit's filling him up. He's not pulling punches. He's telling them the truth. And it's such an amazing sermon. You're looking at it, you're like, how does this guy know this much scripture? He knew his word. He was ready for the moment. This ordinary guy, and he preaches this incredible sermon, and it comes to this climax, and I want to read it to you. This is Acts chapter 7. If you got your Bibles, please, please, please follow with me. Verse 51 and then 8 through 1. I'm going to read it to you. This is the end of his incredible sermon. Verse 51 says, you stiff-necked people. Well, those are fighting words. He's bowing. He's bowing up to the. He's flexing on this 71-person council. How would you like me to start that? Good morning, church, you stiff-necked people. And then he goes, your hearts are still uncircumcised. wow, this is not a seeker-sensitive dude right here. People need the truth. Can I get an amen? The Word of God does its work. So here's the climax of his sermon. You stiff-necked people, your hearts and ears are still uncircumcised. You are just like your ancestors. You always resist the Holy Spirit. Was there ever a prophet your ancestors did not persecute? They even killed those who predicted the coming of the righteous one, and now you have betrayed and murdered him. You have received the law that was given through the angels, but have not obeyed it. Wow. Keeps on going. When the members of the Sanhedrin heard this, they were furious and gnashed their teeth at them. I don't know what that is. I have no idea what it means to gnash your teeth to that degree, but they gnashed their teeth at him. And Stephen, full of the Holy Spirit, it's hard for me not to cry as I read this, looked up to heaven and saw the glory of God and Jesus standing at the right hand of God. Look, he said, I see heaven open and the Son of Man standing at the right hand of God. At this, they covered their ears and yelling at the top of their voices, they rushed at him. And let me just tell you historically, church, they're supposed to have a public trial. This was against the Roman law, but they were so enraged, so convicted, so full of hatred that they didn't go through the right things. They rushed at him. They dragged him in the city and began to stone him. And meanwhile, the witnesses laid their coats at the feet of a young man named Saul. Who is that again, church? While they were stoning him, Stephen prayed, Lord Jesus, receive my spirit. And then he fell on his knees and cried out, Lord, do not hold this sin against them. And when he had said this, he fell asleep. And Saul approved of their killing of him. Wow. The story of the first Christian martyr, which led to the conversion of Stephen. So there's 3 points that I would like to make today. 3 points that I'd like to make that we learn from Stephen. The first is the core of Christian commitment is, what is that, church? Service. The core of Christian commitment is service. This is something, you know, it's so funny how you read the Bible and sometimes you get something totally different out of it than you've ever gotten. But this week I was arrested just at the fact of how much of a servant Stephen was. I've taught about how great his speech was so many times. I've taught about how he stood bold. I've probably preached 14 sermons about how bold Stephen was. But I never saw that one of the greatest things he did was simply serve. The core of Christian commitment is service. Stephen is introduced here as a servant. His job was not glorious. He waited on tables for widows. He obviously was a capable leader, a gifted theologian, and a good preacher. But notice what he didn't say. He didn't say, this is beneath me. I'm going to need something in line with my gifts that people so often say in the church. I'm not going to set up chairs. I just want to preach. You know what I want to say to that? Find a new church. No, I'm kidding. I don't want to be that mean. But people want, they want the limelight, but they don't want to serve, and they're missing the blessing. You know what he said? It's not about me. This is about how I can serve the body of Christ. I began to think in my own life about a story where God really had to humble me, where it's not about me. I used to go on trips with John Hobbs. You guys, anybody know John Hobbs in this room? All right, he's a pretty neat guy. I've told you time and time again, he's one of my greatest mentors that God sent in my life. John taught me it's not about speaking. It's about being a servant. John taught me it wasn't about programs. It was about people. He taught me that it's not just about how good of a communicator you are. It's about how much you love the people and you're willing to wash their feet. That's something seminary doesn't teach you. So All that to say, I'm going on this this retreat with John. We're on this men's retreat, you know, and I'm kind of fresh out of seminary, you know, and I want to flex on people. I'm not going to lie. You know what? I felt like I took a billion classes and spent $50,000 for this education, this theological education, and I wanted people to know my knowledge. And so he's like, all right, Jamie, we're going to go to this conference together, okay? And both of us, I think they want us to speak. And I'm like, let's do this. And I mean, I'm just ready. I put together this sermon about Trinitarianism and community. And I was just so ready. I had all the words like anthropomorphism and exegesis and all the things no one's going to understand but think I'm smart. And I was ready to roll. So we get up there and the conference guy comes out. And I'm just like, sign me up, coach. I'm ready to preach right now. He comes out. He's like, hey, Pastor John, how you doing? Hey, so we need some teacher. I'm just like, let's go. He looks at John. He said, hey, tomorrow night, John, you're going to speak about the Holy Spirit. And I'm like, all right, what night am I? And he looks at me. He's like, so Jamie, yeah, I've heard a lot of good stuff about you. And I'm just like, let's do it. And he looks at me and he goes, hey, Jamie, John, we got you on Tuesday night. But Jamie, what we need from you is will you help pass out waters for the conference? I'm like, I'm sorry, I didn't hear. What did you say? You wanted me to speak about the water of the Holy Spirit? He's like, no, we need you to pass out waters because it's in a tent and it's really, really hot. And I'm like, do you think I'm the water boy? And then to make it worse, and I'm just thinking, what? And they're like, hey, you know, and we need you to feed the band. And, like, this is the hipster worship band. I'm going over to him. I'm like, hey, guys, you know, can I get you guys some food? And the guy's like, well, I'm vegan. Can you go get me a salad? I'm like, I'm going to hit you in the face with a salad with your tight jeans. No, I'm sorry. You know what I'm talking about. They're vegan and gluten-free. And I'm like, can I just go get you a burrito, please? And they're making me go these different places, and I'm serving waters to different people. And for the first night, I'm so ticked off. I can't hear the word of God. I want to preach. And I'm serving these hipsters waters, and they're asking me for Propel. I'm like, go get your own Propel. It's your tight dang jeans. All right. I've been healed. And I'm sitting there, and I'm serving waters to people and different speakers. And the worship is starting to crank. And I get filled with the Holy Spirit. And I'm literally running around. And John's preaching, and I'm running around, and I'm getting people waters, and I'm getting them rags, and I'm doing things that I never, ever felt like I signed up to do. But in the middle of that, I felt the greatest amount of joy. That I felt this sense of peace as I began to serve, and I took out I was willing to take out the towel and be like Jesus. I probably felt better about myself than I've ever felt in my life. And by the end of the conference, Jesus, he showed me a scripture in Mark chapter 9. Because I was thinking, what can I get out of this? And he said, in Mark chapter 9, it says, if any one of my servants even give someone a cold cup of water, he will be blessed. And I can tell you, I grew more, and I've preached some good sermons, and I've went on a lot of different places and speaking, but I felt more fulfilled that day when I was serving and washing people's feet than I ever did in my greatest moment. And I can tell you, that is the secret. Is being a servant. And if you can understand that it's not about you, that's when the miracles can happen in your life. When you're willing to say, there's nothing beneath me. Look, we got a guy that works for NASA here, and he sets up chairs. He's not complaining. That's the best chair setup you've ever seen in your life. Engineered. It's not about me. You say, I want to grow, Pastor Jamie. Stephen teaches us, it's not about you.
You be willing to be a servant. You take the nature of a servant, and I'm telling you, you will start to see miracles. Who saw the water turn to wine? The servants that went and got the wine. They didn't ask questions. They just went and got the big pitchers of wine, of water, and they got to see the miracle. And the more I learn about God and His kingdom, it's the servants that get to experience the miracle. Logan isn't this great, fascinating missionary guy. He's just a guy that says, I know how to BMX, and I'm willing to go to Egypt to share my testimony. And 10,000 people came to know Jesus. Y'all still with me? It's not about you. If you want to change the world, start to serve. Jesus says it like this: the greatest among you will be a servant. That He looks out and all these different people with their big gifts and all their followings. You know what He's really looking for? He's looking for the guy that's willing to serve, to humble, the woman who's willing to humble herself, the man that's willing to humble themselves and say, I'll do anything. If you need me, Pastor Jamie, get here in the morning and to bring donuts, to bring water. If we do a mission trip and you're willing to humble yourself, I'm telling you, you're going to experience the joy of the Lord. This is the attitude Stephen has. And this is what the religious leaders took notice of. Francis Chafer, a good theologian, he says, the service and love of the church is the church's most effective apologetic. That the greatest thing that we can do as a church is not blasting our worship, having the most amazing church buildings, having the most seamless church services where everything flows. It's if we are willing to get on our faces and serve people. That's what the world takes notice of. And that is the testimony of Stephen. You don't even have to get to his boldness. You stop right at the service. That's what Stephen teaches us. And that's why the last emperor of Rome, his name is Julian, he's trying to stop the spread of Christianity. And you know what he said? He says, it's the way they serve each other and serve our people. That's what's creating so many people to know Jesus. They're servants. That's why our desire to this church is that be characterized by a place of service. We want the service to overflow from this church like it did in Acts chapter 6, that everyone in this church would serve. And you might be out there and you say, well, hey, Pastor Jamie, where can I serve? Well, let me tell you a little matrix. Well, let me tell you the answer. Children's ministry. Write it down. That's my second point, children's ministry. Who wants to serve in children's ministry? Not a lot of people, because it is not glorified when you're back there and these little cats are running around. Everybody wants to sign up for evangelism. When I talk about Israel, y'all are going to be ready to roll. When I talk about our mission trip, and you're going to be ready to roll. But you know what we need? We need people to love children. We need people to sit with babies. You say, oh, that's not glorified. That's above my calling. I'm a teacher. I've got all this theological education. Did Stephen say that? He said, I'm willing to wait tables if that's what the body of Christ needs. I'm not sure that waiting on tables was a passion for Stephen. So there's three things, that a little matrix of how you can serve. One, if it's a place of skill, one, if it's a place of passion, or one, if it's a place of need. And sometimes you serve simply because there's a need. Sometimes it's not your passion. Sometimes it's not your gifting. But you say, there's something in the church. There's a need, and I am willing to do it. I'm not sure that waiting on tables was a passion or a skill for Stephen. I'm going to brag on Pastor Colin for a minute here. He's like, stop. So Pastor Colin, he's been serving the Lord for 40 years in ministry, or probably long. She just said 50. I'm sorry, Chris. I stand corrected by you always. how easy would it be for Colin to say, hey, look, I'm retired. Do you know that they have some of the, they're at church every single Sunday. They're not missing church. How easy would it be toward the end of your life to say, you know what, I served for 50 years, I'm done. I'm not going to serve the Church of the Outer Banks. Jamie gets on my nerves anyway. I ain't going to serve that guy. He doesn't even know anything about Anglicanism yet. He doesn't have his robe. He doesn't have his collar. He could have that attitude, but he doesn't. Chris doesn't have that attitude. Do you know how many Christians, as they get older, they decide to retire from ministry? He could be on the golf course. I don't even know if you play golf, Colin, but that would be that's what we want to do, go to the golf course, but not Colin. He's here every Sunday. He doesn't miss. The only time he ever is going to miss is if he has an appointment somewhere, because he's a servant. And he's willing to serve, and he's willing to do whatever it takes to bless the body of Christ here at this church. And I can tell you, I'm very grateful for you, Colin. Are you guys grateful for him too? I want to tell you that probably Stephen didn't want to wait on tables. This wasn't his place of skill or passion. He did it because it needed to be done, because he was a servant. And I can assure you, I can assure you, church, that washing feet was below Jesus' pay grade. Are you with me? Thank you. Jesus didn't wash feet because it was a unique skill in foot washing or he had a special passion for it. Oh, I love to wash feet. That wasn't it at all. He did it because he was a servant. No one has a passion to touch feet. And if you do, that's weird. Who has a passion to get on your hands and knees and wash feet? That wasn't a gifting or a skill. He was teaching them something, that if you want to become great, you become a servant. Philippians chapter 2, verses 5 through 11. This is one of my favorite scriptures in all the Bible. You say, hey, I want to be like Jesus. Everyone in this church should keep saying to themselves, I want to be like Jesus. Well, let me tell you what Philippians 2 says. In your relationships with one another, have the same mindset as Jesus Christ, who being in the very nature of God, he made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a what, church? Can you say that again nice and loud? He made himself, he left heaven. He came down and he took the nature of a servant, being made in human likeness, being found in appearance as a man. He humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, even death on a cross. Jesus says, I'm going to show you what it looks like to be great. I want to show you an example of what I want your life to look like. I'm going to leave heaven and I'm going to come here and I'm going to take the nature of a servant. And I'm going to serve people in the mud with them. People who are caught in adultery. People who are lepers. People who are caught in sin, all sinners. I'm going to eat with them and I'm going to serve them, because that is what it means to be great in the kingdom of God. You see, I want to be great. I want to be great for God because there was a fight going on. Who's the greatest? You want to be great, you be a servant. All right, I've got two more points in 5 minutes. Can I do this? With the Holy Spirit, yes, I can do this. The second thing we learn about Stephen, I'm going to go through this very quick because I want to honor Roy Murray today as we celebrate and honor his life after church, in our church. The man who stood there with his arm raised, worshiping every single Sunday with no complaint. I'm going to get to that. Second lesson we learned from Stephen. Nothing is more important than the what, church? Word of God. Gosh, I wish I had more time. I wish I had more time today, but read chapter 7. This is the longest recorded sermon in Acts. There's 50 verses filled with the Word of God. 22 Old Testament references in 50 verses. One of the things he says, he's looking at this council. Think of how intimidating this council would be. 70 people and one high priest, and they've all been studying the scriptures since they were in 4 and 5 years old. They could quote entire chapters, entire books of the Bible, and you got this one ordinary servant named Stephen, and he's looking at all of them, and he's preaching the most amazing sermon you ever had. 22 Old Testament references. He talks about Abraham. He talks about Joseph. He talks about Amos. He talks about David. It's like this guy knows his Bible more than anyone you see in Scripture. He's going one after another, and he's linking these verses together because Stephen secretly didn't go to theological training. He's a man who knew his word. And when the moment came, they didn't need his opinion. They needed God's word. Y'all with me? Our people, the world, does not need any of my truth. They don't need your opinion. They need the word of God. They need to know the word. And Stephen said, I've hidden the word in my heart. That you can imagine this layman studying his Bible. He didn't have notes. He didn't have PowerPoint. He's right in front of this huge council. And what flows out of him? Scripture after scripture after scripture after scripture. He says, the Most High does not live in houses made by human hands. And if you have the time, go home and read this sermon. There's no opinion, and it's all God's word. Because God's word is alive and active, and it's sharper than a double-edged sword. And what this world needs is the truth of God's word. So that's the second thing he teaches us, is that the word doesn't return void. And you know what's so funny? This thing that he says right here, guess who quotes it later in his life? Paul. The man who was standing there watching Stephen get stoned, he quotes the same verse. He says in Acts 17, the God you made the world and everything in it is the Lord of heaven and earth and does not live in temples built by human hands. That Stephen's speech so impacted Paul that it was written on his heart and the rest of his life he would quote from his sermon. Whew. Okay, the last lesson that that we learn from Stephen is, and this is a very powerful one, remain faithful in your trials. You can say amen. It's okay. Remain faithful in the midst of your trial. He kept his eyes on Jesus, and this is the sweetness of his testimony. Look how he responds. And his response changed the whole world. In the middle of his trial, if you're willing to stay faithful, church, you will minister to people. And I could stand up here and tell you all the different people in our church that have been through trial in the last couple years. And when I see them leaning into Jesus and being faithful, it ministers to me. Let me read it to you. Let's see how he responds. He doesn't whine. He doesn't complain. Look at verse 54. I told you I was going to get readers, but I didn't buy them. Looks like I want to be the hipster guy. All right. Verse 54, he said, when the members of the Sanhedrin heard this, they were furious and gnashed their teeth at him. But Stephen, full of the Holy Spirit, looked up to heaven and saw the glory of God and Jesus standing at the right hand of God. Look, he said, I see heaven open and the Son of Man standing at the right hand of God. Get a picture for a moment. 70 people with stones ready to kill him. At a time that he could just want to bail, or he could blame God, or he could complain. That doesn't come from Stephen's mouth. Look at what he says. As they covered their ears and yelling at the top of their voices, they all rushed him. They dragged him out of the city and they began to stone him. Meanwhile, the witnesses laid their coats at the feet of a young man named Saul. And while they were stoning him, Stephen prayed, Lord Jesus, receive my spirit. Then he fell on his knees and cried out, Lord, do not hold. I don't have it. Lord, do not hold. Yes, I do. Lord, technology. Do not hold this sin against them. And I'm going to come to a close here, church, but I want to say a few things. Paul was not converted by seeing Stephen delivered. Paul was converted by watching Stephen in the midst of his pain give glory to God. I'm going to say that again. Paul was not converted by seeing Stephen delivered miraculously. Paul was converted by watching Stephen in the midst of his pain give glory to God. The Bible says that Stephen, they could see in his eyes as the stones were coming, the glory of God. And what does he say? Father, forgive them. The same thing that you hear Jesus saying on a cross. He was faithful in his trial. You know, I think about Roy Murray. I was thinking about him this week, and we have a celebration of his life. And Roy, if you know anything about Roy, he would come up here with his Eagles jacket on. And I hate the Eagles. I'm not going to lie. All right? But I love Roy. And he's raising his hand. And every time I come over and talk to him, he's talking about trumpets. I don't know what he's talking about. But trumpets and Israel and God. Trumpets and Israel and God. And every time I go over to him, can you imagine for a moment what it would be like to have a stroke and not be able to get out what you want to say? But when I go up to him, and everyone in this church knows this, what do you hear? You don't hear a man who's bitter, who's complaining, why me? Why do I have this stroke? I can't do the things that I used to do. You have a man standing up giving glory to God. Every single time. Every single time I got around him, every time it was about God. Every time it was about Israel. It was about, I want to give glory to God. And it impacted me so deeply. That so many people get bitter and see, I say, I'm not going to get bitter. I'm going to glorify God in the midst of my trial. I can't imagine what it would have been to go through a stroke like that, and you can't communicate the way that you want to. But everything in his language was, I want to give glory to God. So I don't know if you're going through a trial like that, but I want you to know if you are, the thing that you need to remember, your courage and your selflessness goes back to verse 55. He saw Jesus standing at the right hand of God. When you can know that Jesus is on the throne, you can go through anything. If you can remember the sovereignty of God, and what happens? He sees Jesus standing there. Well, theologically, there's no other place in the Bible where Jesus is standing. He's always sitting. Why is he standing? I'll tell you why he's standing. Because earth is condemning Stephen. And Jesus is accepting him. Why is he standing? He's standing because he's welcoming in his servant into his arms. And Stephen says, I'm not going to let this trial define my life. I look out here at a church of people, and there is trials going on in your life. I know there is. But what you're willing to do with that trial, if you're willing to glorify God, the Bible says that's the aroma of Christ. So how do you witness? What do we learn from Stephen as we come to a close? In the worship band, you can come. There's three things. The core of Christian commitment is service. If you want to make an impact, if you want to be an ordinary person, you want to make an impact and start a revival, start to serve. Secondly, you got to know the Word of God, meaning the Bible studies that we offer, you need to get your butt in Bible study. Is that okay to say? You need to get your butt in Bible study. You need to get the Word written on your heart, because when the enemy comes at you, you need to come back at him with God's Word. What does Jesus say over and over to Satan? He doesn't say, well, let me tell you what the culture says. He says, it is what? It is written. Jesus says, I ain't playing with you, Satan. The only thing that's going to come out of my mouth is God's word. Stephen says, if you want to be a witness, you got to know the word. So service, word of God, and lastly, remain faithful in your trial. Turn it around. Say, I'm not going to let this define me. I'm going to use this to glorify God. Yes, something bad's happened to you. This is not the health, wealth, prosperity gospel. This is the power of God meeting you in your trial, filling you up, that you could be a witness to other people. Y'all with me? Let's pray. Father God, I'm just so grateful for the witness of Roy Murray, God. As I thought about Stephen, I think about Roy, and I think about, wow, would I be able to stand up every week with my arms raised and just give glory to God? And I ask you, Lord, that you'd help us to be challenged from your servant, Stephen. That this week, Lord, or even the way that we view church, that we would start to come to church and say, here I am, how can I serve? And I pray, Father, that today you'd give us a renewed passion for the Word of God, that even today that we would go home and we'd say, I want to read it, I want to take it in, I want my life to be defined by God's Word. And thirdly, whatever you're going through, if you're willing to see Jesus standing at the right hand of God, saying, I am with you, even though you walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I am with you. And if you can remember that through the stones, he's in charge, you will be an aroma. And people will see your life, and they will come to know Jesus. So bless this church. Give us the strength to take the gospel to the ends of the earth. In Jesus' name, the God's people said. Would you stand with me as we continue to worship?